Hello and welcome to Charting the New Frontier of Legal Services, Innovation, Exploration, and Evaluation in the Utah Regulatory Sandbox. My name is Zack DeMeola. I'm the Director of Legal Education and the Legal Profession at the Institute for the Advancement of the American Legal System, or IAALS, a National Independent Research Institute at the University of Denver. I'm going to talk a little bit about background and the origins of the regulatory sandbox in Utah, but you know, to do so, I want to set a little bit of a context here, and I'm going to use the story of the experience we had at IAALS, because IAALS early on got involved with the idea that we needed to regulate legal services differently, and that we needed to really understand perhaps the risks involved or the opportunities that present themselves when we do so. So a while back, IAALS created a court compass project. This project really sprouted from our experience in working with self-represented litigants, particularly in family law and in situations of divorce or custody and those sorts of cases. And we were deeply concerned about the experiences of those self-represented litigants and the challenges and difficulties they had in navigating the system. We created essentially a catalog of technology in our Court Compass project. It started as a maturity model and a collection of different technological tools that courts were using and could use to make the process a little more accessible, a little more reachable, and a little easier to navigate. After we did that, we had the idea that we might be able to expand that a little further, that we could scope those sorts of tools and create perhaps an online portal where self-represented litigants could go not only to find information, but also to connect directly to legal assistance in the form of lawyers, legal assistance perhaps through self-help, and also connect directly to the courts in some fashion. The first thing we did is we worked with Margaret Hagen and others to really figure out what the pain points were for self-represented litigants. We wanted to understand what was the most difficult part of the experience for people who had already gone through the system without a lawyer and without much help at all. That was incredibly useful work, and I think it was important work. But the idea of actually creating an online portal to use the feedback we'd gotten from those people and to really facilitate an improvement, something better, we ran into a number of challenges there. We learned almost immediately that things like the unauthorized practice of law or regulations preventing lawyers from connecting to clients in certain ways via technology were going to be an impediment. And we eventually dropped the idea of creating any kind of a model for that portal or scope for that portal. And you know, we learned a few very important lessons. Ultimately, we did have recommendations based on our user experiences on how to simplify and redefine the divorce separation process. But we learned that lasting impact is going to require some systemic changes. The framework we were working with really was limiting, and that we needed a more robust market for innovation. So IAALS started looking into the way legal services are regulated, who can provide legal services, and how they can provide legal services. And the work we did there with Lucy Rica, you'll hear from later on, eventually led to a model of regulation that is very similar to what Utah uses. So I want to start with what some of the challenges, right, that we encountered and that others are well aware of. This is the status quo in the US. We have one of the most highly restricted legal markets in the world. We restrict who can provide legal services, who can invest, who can invent, how legal services are paid for, and how legal technologies are financed. And many of those restrictions come from, as I mentioned before, Rule 5.4, limiting who lawyers can share their fees with and what sort of investments can go into businesses, legal businesses, or partnerships with non-lawyers, and the unauthorized practice of law. We have a number of problems with this because we haven't really defined what the practice of law is. In some jurisdictions, it's sort of anything a lawyer does, which obviously is a little too broad of a scope. Lawyers do quite a few things. Not all of them require highly specialized expertise. Only lawyers can practice law in this country, and corporations or entities, organizations, really can't for the most part. This has led really to a dysfunctional market. I mean, we all know the figures. LSC has shown us that 86% of legal problems reported by low-income Americans they get inadequate or no help. But the reality is that the access gap here reaches far up the income scale. Some of Becky Sandifer's studies suggest that there are 100 million people at any given time in the U.S. with civil justice problems, and you know, of them, they'll only seek help for about 16% of those problems. And the National Center for State Court had a groundbreaking study that demonstrated that 76% of all cases in state court involve at least one self-represented litigant. So we also know there's a coming tide here. The pandemic has really opened this up. I mean, evictions, debt collections, medical expenses, again, family court, things like domestic violence and government benefits. These are all issues that we can expect to balloon in the coming years, a ripple effect from this tidal wave. And we really need to keep in mind that these are public health legal problems, and that there are racial and socioeconomic inequities that are really inherent in a lot of this. You know, if you look at some of the studies that ProPublica did, a study on debt collection and how it just disproportionately hits Black communities in certain areas. So the other thing to consider here is this access to justice crisis really is a crisis for our democracy. If our way of life, if our civic government is based on the rights of the people, and the people don't have access to those rights, we really ought to think about how that affects our democracy writ large. And the 2020 World Justice Project, you know, their rule of law index ranks us pretty poorly relative to other countries around the world. It should really be a wake-up call. Now, we're not here to talk about the trials and tribulations of lawyers, not in an LSC conference necessarily, but it is important to understand that this is a dysfunctional market, that the bar for big law seems to do okay, but they're not serving individual people. They serve corporations, and they have plenty of workarounds to the current regulations. In fact, as Bill Henderson has shown in his legal market landscape report in California, lawyers who serve people just have seen a remarkable market contraction. I mean, fewer and fewer lawyers are serving people. And Clio data shows that lawyers are scraping by, right? They're collecting on 1.6 hours out of an 8-hour workday. And the NCSC has shown us that about 75% of all civil judgments are worth $5,200 or less. So it's not making a lot of economic sense to employ full service counsel in those cases. The other thing to keep in mind is society and our marketplace, we're really dynamic. And this is particularly true with COVID-19. I think the one to many demand for services is being pushed by COVID-19, by the gig economy, the need for remote courts and alternatives to court, and of course, globalization and technology. The problem, of course, though, is that our rules are written for this model, the one-to-one, and our rules are fairly static. They're not good about adapting to changes in a rapidly developed society, technological changes. So we end up in a situation where the regulated universe looks like this. On one side, you've got the state Supreme Courts as the regulator. They delegate to bars, bar associations, to regulate the profession, and then they regulate individual lawyers. Everything else on the other side of the screen is basically unregulated, and that goes for, you know, family, friends, librarians, you know, social workers, and then all of these other companies who are providing different types of services that touch on legal needs. So what comes out of all of this? Well, reform and innovation really are happening now. We know Utah, obviously, we'll be talking about today, has already implemented change, as has Arizona. Arizona is doing entity regulation now and eliminating Rule 5.4 restrictions on who lawyers can partner with and what sort of fees they can share and what kind of investment they can take. The Law Society of British Columbia, too, has recently opened up their own sandbox. And all these other states are in different, on this chart here, are in different periods, different parts, exploring different solutions. And of course, IAALS, as I said from the beginning, we created a model framework for risk-based regulation and independent regulation to address a lot of these problems as well. And we've posted that on our website. I'm gonna hand it off now to Lucy Rica to tell you about how things have developed in Utah and how it works there. Thank you.
Thank you, Zack. So I'm very pleased to be with all of you today. I'm going to talk a little bit about what's actually happening on the ground in Utah, which is pretty exciting, very hard work, very intense kind of intellectual and emotional experience for all of us on the Utah team, but it's really, really rewarding as well. I am I've been involved with this project through IAALS first, in terms of developing out the regulatory model, working closely with Professor Jillian Hadfield and the IAALS team. And now I am the executive director of the Office of Legal Services Innovation at which is an office of the Supreme Court of Utah. So I will wait for 1 second.
Apologies.
There we go. All right. So I want to start with what exactly the model is. It's really, the Utah model has gotten a lot of coverage for the sandbox piece of it, which is a really important part of the entire project. But at its core, what the Utah project is and what the model is a new regulatory approach for legal services. That is the central piece of this entire project. And that is kind of encompasses the sandbox, oversees the sandbox, and hopefully will live beyond the sandbox. So, you know, what we started with in Utah was this challenge of, you know, the current regulation of individual lawyers just isn't working for where the market is moving. And it's constricted the market so much that most people are not accessing legal help. So how can we develop out a regulatory approach that's going to facilitate innovation and new business models and new providers in a really diverse and flexible marketplace, but that protects consumers at its core. So really focusing in on opening up the market while identifying those concerns that are really about consumer protection. So that's what you see in front of you now. So we have in Utah a new regulator, which is the Office of Legal Services Innovation. Right now we're entirely within the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court is the be all and end all when any decision, really. But the new regulator has this new approach, which is essentially a risk-based, objectives-based approach to regulation. So the traditional approach, our rules of professional conduct, is what we call a prescriptive or rule-based approach to regulation. It's very static, it's very strict, it's very clear for the most part. You know, you've got these rules written down, they're very detailed, but it's not so flexible and it's not so responsive, and it doesn't work well with a market that's changing rapidly, which is what we have in legal, particularly when you layer in technology. So the new model sets out a really clear regulatory objective and says, this is what this entire project is meant to meet. You know, this new regulator, these entities within this regulatory system, this is your goal. And so the regulatory objective is, as you see, to ensure consumers have access to a well-developed, high-quality, innovative, affordable, and competitive market for legal services. So there's a lot in there, but I think we worked really hard to make it quite clear that what we're focusing on is high quality. So that gives us the objective of protecting consumers from poor quality services. And then all these aspects of competition and innovation that we want to see writ large across the economic spectrum. We also have a set of regulatory principles which guide kind of our everyday decision making on regulatory action. So, you know, what sort of processes we build up, if we have any kind of, you know, ex ante rules, you know, how we identify sort of risk categories and how we make decisions on enforcement. These regulatory principles are meant to guide every one of those decisions. And so we state that they're risk-based, which means they're focused on the risk of undermining the attaining that regulatory objective. They are empirical, which means that at every step of the way, we try to be guided by data instead of assumptions, which is really different to our current system. Proportional means that a regulatory response is not going to be excessive, you know, where possible. So we acknowledge that this system, there are going to be, you know, individual instances of harm in this system that are not going to require a blanket regulatory response because that doesn't make a lot of sense. Relative to the actual status quo means that we assess consumers where they are, and we assess solutions based on how they're on the consumers they're proposing to serve. And if we know, as we do, that most consumers are getting no help at all, What this principle means is that the standard is never going to be the best lawyer providing full representation for an individual client, because that is not where most people are. So we start where most people are, which is they're trying on their own to figure out something that was never built for them in the first place. And if a solution can get them a little bit better than that, even if it's not as good as a lawyer, we're okay with that. And the final piece is market-based, which is we really want to try, the market for legal services has been so restricted for so long that it isn't a functional tool. There isn't competition in any real sense. There isn't innovation. There isn't sort of consumer access. And so market-based says we're going to allow the market forces to have a strong role here. So we're not going to say up front, oh, hey, we don't think this model isn't going to succeed, so we're not going to allow it to happen. We'll allow it to happen. And if the market says that this model stinks, you know, this service model, then it's going to fail. And that's okay. So that's kind of the overarching umbrella approach. And then what you see down here on the bottom are the three high priority harms that we've identified, that if these three harms occur in any material or significant way in our system, then we are failing to reach the regulatory objective, right? So we've tried to distill our concerns about, you know, risks to consumers into these three harms. So the consumer gets bad or inaccurate legal help, wrong legal help. That's poor quality issue. Consumer fails to exercise a legal right because their provider didn't identify it, help them identify it. That's a poor quality issue. And then consumer buys an unnecessary or inappropriate service. That's an upselling issue. And those three issues, we really thought very hard about trying to distill all the potential concerns into really clear and simple terms. And we felt that these three got at that. So that's sort of the overarching thing or overarching framework for the regulatory model. So this is what you have now in Utah. We have the Utah Supreme Court, which is, you know, the regulator of the practice of law in Utah. It's through the Constitution. And we've got the Utah State Bar on one side using the rules of professional conduct to regulate lawyers and through lawyers, traditional law firms. But now we have another side to that. We have the Office of Legal Services Innovation, which is using that risk-based regulation framework that I just discussed. And we are overseeing non-traditional legal services and providers. And Zach, if you'll just click this is the sandbox right here. So non-traditional legal services and providers include law practices that are owned by non-lawyers or invested in by non-lawyers. And it also includes non-lawyer provision of services, whether by software or by humans. So we can go to the next slide. So it's pretty simple how this works, at least in theory, although there are lots of little quirky things that have popped up that we deal with on a day-to-day basis. I think it must be the name of the game when you're building something new from scratch like this. But essentially, you know, we, the Office of Legal Services Innovation, we have an application on our website, and an entity will come and they'll fill out the application, which basically says, tell us what you're proposing to do, which you would think would be simple, but actually really tricky with entrepreneurs, and particularly entrepreneurs who are lawyers, because it's so unusual to see kind of this, you know, we've really opened up an entirely new market. And so people are having trouble clearly articulating what they're proposing to do. So it takes a little work on that piece. You tell us what kinds of risks there might be for consumers in your proposal. This, we really wanted to encourage applicants to kind of undertake a risk self-assessment as they think about the model that they're proposing. This is also proven challenging, not surprisingly, because you're asking entrepreneurs to tell you how they think that their product is going to harm consumers, and they don't love to think about that. But we push them on it, and it's in this steps one and two are an iterative process. There's a fair amount of back and forth, particularly on clarifying exactly what's being proposed and what the risks are therein. And then we, the Innovation Office, assess that application, and we kind of tease out if there's other risks that we feel are present there and need to be addressed, and we'll, you know, go back to the entity and deal with that. And then we categorize them into a risk category, We've developed out a model that sort of sets out initial risk categorization for entities. And it's really based on how far away from the status quo they come. So the highest risk entities, at least at the entities that we would categorize as high risk at the front end, are entities where you have software or non-lawyer provision without lawyer oversight. We haven't had any applications like that, but you can see that's the farthest away from the status quo. So that would be the highest risk, and we would watch that the most closely. But anyway, so we categorize these models and we write up a recommendation for the court that describes what's being proposed and sets out the service areas that the entity is proposing to work in and sets out what, you know, the risk model is. And they decide, ultimately the court is the arbiter, and it's been a lot of, the court is very active in this. So it's a lot of back and forth discussion with the Utah Supreme Court. And then once it's authorized, we go back to the entity and we say, okay, here's your risk level and here's the data that you have to report and here's the frequency with which you have to report. And then we also have consumer disclosures that they have to make depending on what they're proposing to do. And then they go off and they start providing their services and they start reporting data to us and we watch for harm. So we can go to the next slide. So the kind of data, this is really where the rubber meets the road for this model. If this data piece doesn't work, then this model isn't going to work. But I do think this is obviously more than any lawyer ever has to do. I mean, I think legal aid lawyers are the only ones who have to report in any sort of regular way on what they do. But most lawyers don't. And so, frankly, this model for data was taken a lot from what legal aid is already doing. Entities have to report across these fields. It sort of depends, what they have to report depends on the risk level that's been assigned. Everyone has to report on consumer complaints, and consumer complaints can also come directly into the office. Moderate and high risk entities have to report on things like legal outcomes and financial outcomes. They have to report on the amount that everyone has to report on the amount that a consumer pays, and everyone's reporting on sort of the duration of service and the scope of service that's sought. So we track all of that. And for most entities, it's on a monthly basis. These are monthly reporting requirements. So it's case level data. This is really, really detailed stuff that we are getting on a very high frequency from these entities. The lowest risk entities will have, it's fine, you can stay there. The lowest risk entities will have quarterly reporting requirements, but still that's a pretty high frequency. So this is who we're hoping to see in the sandbox. I should clarify, So the sandbox is sort of the controlled space in which this new regulatory operation is happening. This is what we're hoping to see. And frankly, we've seen a lot in the first two buckets right now. The gold at the end of the rainbow for me is the last two pieces. But the first two pieces we've seen a lot, traditional law firms and legal nonprofits with new service models and legal tech startups. We've also seen a fair amount of, well, not a fair amount, but we've seen a couple of ancillary professional services who want to hire lawyers. And I'll talk a little bit more about specific examples that are in already in a minute. But these last two, new offerings by well-established companies and then community organizations who are already offering frontline social services. I think if we were able to get some of these types of services in the sandbox, whether in Utah or in Arizona or wherever, that's where I think we'll really start to see major change for people on the ground, for folks who we know have significant civil legal problems and who could use help across a variety of mechanisms. We haven't seen this yet, and we are doing some work kind of outside with Anna Carpenter's lab at the University of Utah to try and develop out particularly nonprofit focused opportunities. It's a harder lift with that last piece, the community orgs and nonprofits, because we know they're already so strapped, and this is a big leap that's never been available before. So we're trying to do some work on that piece. We can go to the next slide. Oh yeah, so we are up and running. We have been up and running since the beginning of September. It's bootstrapped. It's been bootstrapped from the beginning, but we actually do have funding now from the State Justice Institute, and hopefully more incoming foundational funding as we move forward. But we have a board that's made up of non-lawyers and lawyers appointed by the court. And then the staff of the office is myself, the executive director. We have a wonderful data analyst who's come on board, and then a project manager. And all of us are part-time at this point. I think really to make this functional, we need to be full-time. And so I'm working toward that goal on the funding piece. We have 33 applications and 12 approved entities. So really this is, and these are entities that were never, have not been allowed in the United States legal profession or legal services market for over 100 years. So that's pretty exciting. Next slide. So real quick, these are just some of the entities that have been authorized. They're kind of running the gamut, but you'll see they're really still at this point lawyer driven. And I think, you know, I'm really hopeful that we'll see more non-lawyer driven stuff, because I think that's going to be really innovative in a way that the lawyers just aren't at this stage. But, you know, Rocket Lawyer, for example, a lot of people know Rocket Lawyer. They are, they have hired a lawyer employee. And so it's a non-lawyer owned legal tech company. And they have a lawyer employee who's as a Rocket Lawyer employee is providing legal services to the public, supplementing their form completion stuff. Another interesting one, LawHQ is a plaintiff's firm that has an app that they, so they're taking outside investment, and then they have an app that is facilitating evidence collection for their mass tort litigation related to spam calls. And then they also have, they have more extensive plans for sort of a self-service tool as well. Let's see. AGS and Bluebee are both low-risk entities, or Bluebee is low-risk, AGS I think is low to moderate, but they both are just sort of part equity partnerships between lawyers and non-lawyers, but the lawyers are still providing all of the legal service. So One Law and Law Pal are both kind of form and chatbot developments. You know, I think the goal for both of them is to really have more robust non-lawyer provision. At this stage, they're relatively limited, but I think down the line, that's what their plan is. So we'll see where that goes. So that's some of the examples. There's more. I'd be happy to talk about more if people have questions, but those are some of the examples of where we are now. Oh, yes. And sorry, this will go into Logan, but we do, external evaluation of the Utah project is like extremely important to us, because you know, our team is made up of folks who are data folks, Rebecca Sandifer, Dr. Tom Clark from National Center for State Courts. And the court really feels that external evaluation is paramount for this project. So we have a whole bunch of folks that are lined up and ready to go, including IAALS, which is gonna be great.
Right, thanks, Lucy. I am Logan Cornett. I am the Director of Research at IAALS, and I'm going to talk a little bit about evaluation strategies generally, because I think that's really important background for talking about evaluation. And then I'm going to, of course, talk specifically about what we're doing in Utah. So to sort of start at the very beginning, why do we evaluate? So careful evaluation design and systematic data collection are going to allow us to really understand whether the goals of regulatory reform are being met, and they allow us to gather credible evidence about what's working and what's not, and then give us some information and guidance to improve those things that aren't working, if that's the case. And then, of course, ultimately, we want to inform the future of regulation in Utah and in other states. So I'm also going to give just sort of a very brief primer on the different types of evaluation, because I think that when we think about evaluation, generally what we're thinking about is outcomes and impacts. But the reality is that there are a lot of different kinds of evaluations, some of which deal with outcomes and impacts and some of which don't. But all of them are really critical to the success of social programs. So the first type is needs assessment, and this is basically just understanding what the needs are of a certain population. A lot of times this can be done by just gathering existing research that's already out there. The second is program theory assessment, which is after you've understood what the needs are and developed an idea for a program. It's really asking the question of whether the program that you've designed is designed in a way that it can actually achieve its goals. The next is process evaluation. So once you've developed and implemented that program, this asks the question of whether the program is actually operating the way that it was intended. And actually, implementation problems can be a huge issue in failures of social programs. Next, of course, is our outcomes and impact evaluations. And I think that oftentimes people conflate these two things, but they're actually different. Outcomes evaluation refers to looking just within the sphere of the program and what outcomes are for program participants. Impact evaluation is a comparison between what happens for participants of a social program and what happens for folks that don't receive program services. So this is oftentimes involves comparison and control groups, and this is where things like experimental and quasi-experimental design come in. And then finally, there's the cost effectiveness evaluation, which is really just asking whether the benefits of a program justify its costs. All right. And so regardless of the type of evaluation we're conducting, it's really, really important that our evaluations are question driven. I think sometimes there is an inclination to just jump straight into identifying what the outcomes should be and what measures we should use to assess those outcomes. But the reality is that a good evaluation design begins with identifying your evaluation questions. And what that does is it really helps to focus your evaluation and assure that whatever you're measuring is actually going to answer the questions that are most important to you. And then, of course, in the process of identifying and developing these evaluation questions, it's important to involve various stakeholders in that process. All right, so moving on to what's actually going on in Utah and what we are doing there. So our evaluation is really divided into four sort of buckets. So I'm gonna walk through each of these and share some of the questions that we've developed for each. The first is a regulator process evaluation. So some questions that we're asking here is, what does the risk profiling process look like? What are the steps that are involved? What's the timeline for that process? And how close is what's actually happening to what was planned? We're also interested in knowing what staff roles and responsibilities are, how staff are trained, and how participation in the sandbox is encouraged. The second bucket is taking a look at the landscape of sandbox providers. And what's going on in the sandbox. So some of our questions here are how many applications are submitted, and of those, how many are approved and denied, and what are the reasons for that? What kinds of services are those applications proposing? What are the levels of risk that are assessed for each? How much do these services cost, and what are the fee structures? How many clients are these providers serving, and what are the demographic characteristics of those clients? The third bucket is looking at client outcomes. So what are clients' experiences of sandbox services? Do those experiences differ depending on the kinds of services that they are getting? What is the quality of services offered in the sandbox? Do clients achieve appropriate outcomes? Do clients experience disproportionate amounts of harm, and are clients satisfied with their experiences? And then our final bucket is legal market outcomes. So here we're asking things like, to what degree are sandbox services novel or innovative? How do sandbox providers view their experiences? How do traditional providers view the sandbox generally, and sandbox providers specifically? And do those perceptions change over time? So to answer these many, many questions, we have developed a set of strategies for collecting data. One of those is collecting data from the regulator, a lot of the stuff that Lucy was talking about just a minute ago, as well as conducting our own interviews and focus groups and administering surveys to clients and sandbox providers, as well as to folks in the innovation office. And then finally, we anticipate doing some blind expert review of sandbox legal services provided in the sandbox. And the idea here is to get an objective assessment of service quality. So where are we now? We have not yet started collecting data. We are currently in the process of developing our survey instruments and interview protocols, strategizing around what that blind expert review process is going to look like, working on a data sharing agreement so that we can get the data that we need from Utah, and also just sort of doing some general planning for our data collection approach. And so where do we hope to be? Of course, as Lucy outlined in great detail earlier, some of the goals of risk-based regulation in Utah are to increase access to legal services, increase the degree to which services are innovative while maintaining consumer protection in a scalable and sustainable way. And I just want to reiterate that the systematic data collection that IAALS is doing for our evaluation of Utah is really going to allow us to understand whether those goals are being met. And then of course, the data will also have huge policy implications for what happens in Utah in the future, but also for the future of legal regulation across the country. So I'll hand it back over to you, Zack, to close us out.
Thank you, Logan, and thank you, Lucy. As you can tell, there's a lot of work being done now, and there's a lot of work ahead, but I think one of the most important things to take away from this is a theme that has been brought up again and again in this presentation, which is that it's no longer sufficient to rely on the assumptions, many of which were created in another era of American society and of the legal profession to regulate and create restrictions on how people can access the legal services that they need. What we're talking about here is a very rigorous attempt to gather evidence, to understand the facts that underlie those assumptions and really test them, right? And once and for all, know which of those assumptions are based on fact and which of those are not. The implications here are enormous, and we'll know for better or worse which services work, which services are effective, and truly, how to protect the people who need the services. And I think that's one last point to make. All of this that you're hearing is a new process that is far more proactive and preventative of harm than the current disciplinary reactive system that we have. And I think everybody on this panel and involved in the Utah effort would put the well-being of the people who need these services as one of the highest priorities. This is a far more robust way of ensuring people can get the help they need and get it safely. Thank you all, and we look forward to your questions.